Buenas noches. Hace unos días se presentó el informe de un grupo de expertos coordinado por la famosa y prestigiosa London School of Economics, titulado Acabando con la guerra contra las drogas. El informe concluye que es hora de acabar con la llamada guerra contra las drogas y de redirigir recursos masivamente hacia políticas efectivas basadas en datos duros y apuntaladas por un riguroso análisis económico. Cabe señalar que el informe coordinado por John Collins de la LSE y en el que colaboraron varios expertos de distintas especialidades fue firmado ni más ni menos que por 5 premios Nobel de Economía, además de distinguidas personalidades como Nick Clegg, viceprimer ministro del Reino Unido de la Gran Bretaña e Irlanda del Norte, George Shultz, exsecretario de Estados Unidos, y Javier Solana, exalto representante de la Unión Europea para Políticas Exteriores, entre otros. Y para platicar de este interesante e importantísimo informe, nos acompaña su coordinador John Collins, así como Armando Santa Cruz, quien es el presidente de México Unido contra la Delincuencia. John, Armando, welcome. Thank you for coming. Gracias, gracias por venir. So let's start by talking about the report. What's on the report?
Well, basically, the idea behind this report was trying to look, to take a step back and look what is a more effective way to deal with drugs internationally at a multilateral level. Because there's broad agreement, really, when you look across this political spectrum and certainly at the academic level, there's pretty broad agreement that a war on drugs is not an effective way to manage global drug policy. So it's about scaling back and reversing path from the war on drugs and trying to find a new strategy forward to more effectively manage this issue.
Let's take a step back from the current situation and try to understand how we got here. Sure. I understand that that is precisely the topic of your research, exactly how we got here. How would you summarize that story? How did we get here?
Well, essentially, the idea that underpins drug policy for the last century is that by controlling supply, you can control demand. So all resources, all efforts at the international level were directed towards controlling the supply of drugs. And then consumer countries felt that that would stop consumption in their countries. That didn't work. The more we moved towards a prohibitionist framework, a criminalized framework around that, the more we saw criminal gangs step into the fold and start to take control of the market. So the trajectory of control since about 1909, 1912 has been control supply, you can control demand, and it just simply hasn't worked. And so every time that we see evidence that it hasn't worked, the international response has been double down. Do more. We need to direct more resources towards it. We need more political effort towards stopping this trade. And I think finally within the last few years there has been a recognition actually this is not going to work. It can never work. It's the same as alcohol prohibition in the United States. As long as there's a demand, there will be a supply.
Was this driven by a particular country? I mean, most people tend to blame the US, that it's the US that's behind this. The UN clearly also adopted this policy, but a lot of people would argue that it was because of the US or US pressure that we have this particular strategy. Is that right? Are they to blame?
I think without the US, we absolutely would not have the current strategy at the international level. There just wouldn't have been this ideological viewpoint, this member state with sufficient power to push through the current framework. I think there was a broad level of support for this kind of prohibitionist framework, or it certainly developed, but I think the US is the core actor within this.
Let me ask you, Armando, what's the role of Mexico Unido contra la Delincuencia in this report?
Well, Mexico Unido contra la Delincuencia was founded as a response to the growing level of crime, and especially violent crime in this country. So as the years went by, we realized that there was an elephant in the room that was called drug policy. So anything we did in terms of trying to reduce crime would go nowhere if we didn't address drug policy. So we started studying the drug policy and ended up getting involved to the point that we now one of our 4 most important programs is drug policy. Okay. We have an alliance with a Transform Drug Policy Foundation from Britain, where we have an active core of people who both study, publish, and push the idea around. So what we've been doing here is we've collaborated a lot with several of the authors in this report. We have helped John divulging this report along the way. And we've worked with several of the people like Alejandro Madrazo from CIDE on this. And basically what we believe is that we are addressing a health problem through a police strategy. Yeah. And addressing a health problem through policemen is not the best way to address something. I always tell when people tell me, but what do you expect, you know? And I say, well, if one of your kids was caught with drugs, what would you rather have? A policeman deal with them or a doctor deal with them? Mm-hmm. It's as simple as that. And I don't know a single prohibitionist who will say, oh no, I would rather have the police deal with them. You know.
And so what people answer you?
when confronted with that question, they say, well, actually, with a doctor.
Exactly.
If your kid robbed a bank, would you rather he be confronted by the police or a doctor? You would also pick a doctor.
Well, that's a good point.
It's okay. But
although the doctor will find a harder time curing the
Exactly.
You say that the war on drugs has been a failure, or that there is a general consensus that it's been a failure. What is the evidence? Because a lot of the report talks about that failure. Mm. Give us an example of the empirical evidence that allows you to claim that it's been a failure.
Sure. Well, yeah. I generally think whatever area of policy you look at that the war on drugs interacts with, it has a negative impact on. So if we look at development policies, the war on drugs has a tremendously negative impact. If we look at countries in Latin America, it has a direct link with the flight of capital. People will not invest in countries with high levels of violence. It displaces population. It corrupts political processes. It undermines public health. So we look at various aspects of public health policy where there is a huge evidence base suggesting that they actually work. There's things like syringe exchange programs. For every dollar invested in a syringe exchange program in a lot of countries, you see a $27 return. And yet money is not being directed towards those areas, those things that actually yield public health benefits, because of this ideological perception that, well, then we're not fighting a war on drugs. We're not reaching an endpoint where people have stopped using drugs altogether. So it's across a broad spectrum of, if you look at incarceration of populations, that's people who are pulled out of their communities, put into jail at a direct cost to society, but then at a social cost to themselves as well. And so you could probably start to put dollar figures on this. One of the figures that was thrown out at the conference where we discussed this report, in the United States alone, the social costs of the war on drugs are estimated about $500 or $600 billion.
$16 billion.
In terms of the social costs
per annum.
Mm-hmm. So it's enormous. The social cost, the political cost, the economic cost. Alejandro Madrazo speaks of the legal institutional cost. It's very hard to have a society that can develop effectively if you haven't got solid political and legal institutions. And the war on drugs corrupts those. It undermines those. So these are all costs that we've only begun to quantify. This report is really the first step in trying to quantify these costs. And we're starting at a pretty low research base, to be honest, in this field, because it was so politicized for so long. But so that we're really moving towards trying to put dollar figures on those.
Let me just add a couple of things that I think are very explicit about the failure of this. There's more incarceration, there's harsher penalties, and the price of drugs keeps going down, and availability keeps going up, and purity keeps going up. Mm-hmm. So that's exactly the opposite of what you would expect if this was a successful strategy.
Actually, it's a complete failure, I would say.
Right. And another thing that I find very interesting is, at least talking about Mexico, mm-hmm. if you look at the deaths as a consequence of legal drugs or of many illnesses such as obesity, diabetes, and others, they are much higher than the deaths by use of illegal drugs. When the war on drugs starts with President Calderon, then you start getting a higher homicide rate. So now there's many more people killed through the war on drugs, through the violence involved with the war on drugs, than with the drugs themselves. In other words, to make an analogy, I always think in terms of saying, if there was a vaccine that would prevent an illness that kills 5% of the people who get ill, but the vaccine kills 10% of the people who get ill, well, you wouldn't vaccinate them. You know, the cost of the cure is higher than the illness itself. So let's learn to live with the illness. It's the violence that goes with the war on drug has killed many more people than the drugs themselves.
Yeah, if I could give another example, Daniel Mejia, in his contribution to the report, highlights that probably 25% of the homicides in Colombia are directly related to the war on drugs.
25%.
Yes. So we're talking thousands of homicides over multi-decade period. If you multiply that by a valuation of what people's life, economists all the time put valuation on what a human life is worth in terms of years lived, you start to get into hundreds of millions and billions of dollars again. These calculations have not yet been done, but this is an example of some of the costs.
Let me mention one of the papers in the report which would seem to go against what you're saying, and that is the Calkins paper about the costs and benefits of...
Let me just interrupt you and say that the report is a compilation of several papers.
Yeah.
It's not just one informed, it's actually several essays, several reports, some of them with several ideas, I mean, with confronting ideas, no?
Yeah, although I would say that the majority of them clearly point to the failure of the war on drugs.
Absolutely.
The one essay that doesn't really do that, or does that as clearly as one would think, is the Calkins paper.
Mm-hmm.
And the first thing that I guess you get when you read that article, the essay, is that there is a clear asymmetry between producer and transshipment countries and consumer countries. And he only makes the case for consumer countries, and I'm going to quote his one of his conclusions. He says, and I quote, "Even granting that prohibition's costs are enormous, as you've just mentioned, it does not automatically follow that those costs outweigh potential benefits from reduced dependence, because the benefits may also be very large, i.e. prohibition or a certain type of prohibition works, because the costs of not having it would be even higher." I was surprised to find that essay and to find that conclusion.
Well, it's good for the debate.
And it's sort of well argued, puts numbers to the costs of prohibition and the benefits of prohibition, and comes out with a result that maybe the benefits are greater.
I hesitate to speak on another contributor's paper, and John Calkins is one of the best academic minds we have in drug policy. The figure that he comes to is about $140 billion. If you take people's quality of life assessment and the loss of that quality of life assessment based on if they develop problematic issues with drugs, if prohibition dissuades that, it then saves $140 billion a year. The number that came up to counter that in the conference was, well, probably the social costs are $500 or $600 billion a year. So that doesn't add up. I think my personal view is that he understates the cost of prohibition in the US. He mentions the direct cost at the federal level, which is about $40 billion a year. That's how much the federal government spends on drug policy. It's not the actual social cost, the cost to society of implementing drug policy. It's a very valid argument, and I think the part of this we need to think about is, what is an effective prohibition? And I think this is my view of this is at base of what John Calkins is arguing, is that minimally enforced prohibition drastically raises the prices of illicit drugs. It's, you can't pay DHL to ship cocaine from Colombia to America. You have to find an alternative route, and that raises the prices drastically. The thing is that a lot of the evidence that's coming out now is saying every additional dollar you spend enforcing prohibition has no impact on prices, and actually can drive violence and drive all sorts of other problems associated with it. So if we roll prohibition back, and John Calkins says it in his article, you could roll prohibition back, the spending on it by 50% in the United States, and not see any major increase in drug consumption, but the social cost of prohibition will decrease dramatically.
Yeah, I mean, it seems to me that an interesting argument for us here in Mexico, or an interesting conclusion from his paper for us here in Mexico, is that there seem to be... it might make sense for the US to maintain some sort of prohibition, and not make any sense whatsoever for Colombia or for Mexico for the US to maintain prohibition. And the problem is, we need to come up with a joint strategy. And if there are genuine incentives to maintain some sort of prohibition, that's not going to solve our problem.
If I may, this was an issue that came up in the conference, and Professor Danny Quah of the LSE, who chaired this report, highlighted this is a global justice issue. This is the North outsourcing the costs of drug control to the global South. And we could think of various issues, you know, environmental waste. Of course it makes sense for the global North to outsource it to the global South and not want to pay any of the cost of disposing it, but it doesn't make any sense from the global South's perspective to keep implementing the same policies.
You wanted to say something?
Well, it was along those lines. Before we started the discussion, we were talking with Javier, that one of my disagreements with that paper is that it talks of a closed market, not considering the effects in the surrounding countries. Mm-hmm. So if you look at it strictly from a single market, I don't concede that it could work, that it works, but it could work. Although there are other costs. Beside the cost of outsourcing, there's the cost of national security for the U.S. or whichever country maintains criminal structures beyond its borders, providing those drugs as a result of the prohibition in that country. Mm-hmm. So I think we can no longer analyze the drug problem as a single country problem. It's a worldwide problem, and there's the famous balloon effect. If you push here, the bump will come up over here, and if you push here, it'll come up over here, and the problem will not disappear. It'll only move along different places.
Now, the problem for Mexico is in the supply part of the equation, no? I mean, we don't have a problem with lots of consumption or demand of drugs. We are part of the supply chain of drugs to the U.S. mainly, no? That's our problem.
Which is only convalidates what John is saying about the outsourcing of the problem to Mexico. We do have a problem that is growing, but it's growing from a very small base. Yeah. If you compare the public health effects of drug use in Mexico to the public health effects of the war on drugs, it's just totally out of proportion.
Yeah.
So I totally agree with you.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the argument would seem to be an argument against legalizing, at least. The conclusion, I think, from the Corking paper is an argument against legalizing, not an argument in favor of maintaining the current strategy, but it's more an argument, I guess, against legalizing.
We have to go to a commercial break, because I want to talk about solutions in the next segment. Mm-hmm. So let's make a commercial break, and we're going to come back. Estamos platicando con Armando Santa Cruz y John Collins sobre este informe. Este es el informe, por cierto, acabando con la guerra contra las drogas. Es un informe de LSE, de la London School of Economics, de la serie Ideas. Que por cierto, Armando, se puede bajar gratuitamente
en la página de México Unido contra la Delincuencia, www.mucd.org. Ahí pueden bajar este y todas estas publicaciones que tenemos que tratan
de una
tema.
Vez que está terminando la guerra contra las drogas, cómo ganar el debate en América Latina. Está cómo regular el cannabis, una guía práctica. Y una propuesta para la regulación después de la guerra contra las drogas. Bueno, pues ahí está.
Y además ciertos escritos específicos para preocupaciones específicas, que si ha funcionado o no el modelo holandés, que si ha funcionado o no el modelo portugués, pueden bajarlos también en nuestra página.
Bueno, pues ahí está, hacemos una breve pausa y ahora regresamos al tema de las soluciones, ¿no? Regresamos en un momento más.